Amen. That was beautiful.
Good morning. Morning. It's a blessing to have you here to worship our Lord and Savior. I pray each and everyone would feel God's presence and know that we've all been made in the image of God. And God desires a relationship with us that is real, that is personal. And what a blessing that is. And so at this time, if there's any announcements, raise your hands and the ushers will bring you a mic. That's right, yeah. Deanna has
one. Good morning. The church office is going to be open Monday and closed Tuesday because we have a funeral.
So the church office will be open tomorrow and closed Tuesday. All right.
We found out this week Nancy's been having some problems, she thought, with her heart. And lo and behold, she went to the doctor and they had four things. The heartbeat itself, some atrial fib, and blah, blah, blah. So we're kind of pursuing that now through the local doctors, and he'll get us an appointment with somebody in Salina. But I wish you'd keep her in your prayers. Doesn't look like a woman with a heart problem, but you never know, I guess. But I know there are a lot of people that get to be our age that have these things crop up. So keep praying for the whole church. Praying for the community. My pocket was up. Okay. We're so fortunate to be living where we live. It's a well-kept secret, and let's keep it that way. So if you've got relatives in California or New York, treat them nice, but don't invite them to visit you. No, I'm just kidding. We are blessed, and keep Nancy in your prayers. We'll find out more in the next month or so. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Yes, we'll keep Nancy in her thoughts and prayers, and it is a blessing to be here. That's true. I thought you was going to be like my mother used to say, that family, you know, relatives and fish are a lot in common. After 3 days, they both start to stink. But anyway. And it's great to see Rose, and I hear the throat isn't too bad yet, and she's able to communicate, and we praise God for that. 2 days left, right? Yeah, 2 days left of treatment. So please keep Rose in your thoughts and prayers also. Are there any other?
And Betty's here.
And Betty's here. And her blood pressure is a little low right now. So that's why she's sitting in the back. At one time in one church, she actually fainted. And it wasn't anything that I said. And but anyway... As I was preaching, I noticed my spouse was no longer with us. And I said, would someone please check the pew and see how my wife is doing? And they did that, and she's still with us today, and that's a blessing. But, yes. Are there any other announcements? I know on Tuesday, I think we need some helpers for commodities. Isn't that right? And that's behind the hospital. And that's to put things together. They already have, they'll tell you what to put in a box and everything else. And there's all kinds of helpers. If you miss it, they're glad to let you know. And if I can learn, any of you can. And then also, they pick it up at 2. And be there about 1:45, so that could be delivered too. They pick it up, right?
11 on Tuesday, when we need
possible. Okay, that's when they need all the help, is 11 on Tuesday. Okay, thank you. Are there any others?
Debbie's pretty quiet, but she probably has something to say.
Well, I guess I'll say something. I agree with Stoney about living in Ellsworth. We are very blessed, and I think I've been thinking about that just actually last week, how blessed we are in a small community. We have a great community that cares about everybody. It really, truly, it's very lovely.
Yeah. You know, and that's so true. I mean, Betty and I have witnessed that. We have felt that while we were under quarantine with COVID, all the meals and the prayers and the cards. It is such a blessing. We do want to lift up our country with the presidential power that will be changing on Wednesday. We want to lift that up, and we pray for peace. And we just need to pray for direction and guidance, and that we would be the people that God calls us to be. You know, and that's a really, really quite a prayer concern. I'm going to have a prayer to center us, and then, or do you want to just talk about moments for mission right now? Okay, if you would.
Today, as you see, it's for the fire department, and here again, we have an outstanding fire department, and it's all volunteer, and they have great equipment, and so in our little amount that we can give them, maybe can help buy Gatorade, water, or whatever they need, but honestly, it's a privilege to be able to help them. It really is. Oh, baskets. Sorry. Yes. Baskets are all out. One's up here. There's one in the back. And there's one in the foyer. So.
Okay. So before you leave, you can put it in the basket then. Okay. The offering for the fire department. Okay. Thank you. Are there any other announcements? Okay. If not, I'll have a centering prayer. I'm going to ask you to not only bow your heads, but open your hearts and your minds, but also would you open your hands? Let us go to the Lord right now. Gracious God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the opportunity to worship you and praise you. Dear Lord, you love us so much that you sent your only begotten Son to pay the price for our sins. Dear Lord, we want to come today and just focus and worship and praise you because you are so worthy. And dear Lord, we can say it, but many times we're not doing it. I can't speak for anyone else, but many times I'm holding on to anxiety. I'm holding on to brokenness. I'm holding on to worry. And dear Lord, we weren't meant to carry it. We weren't even made to carry it. 700 times you tell us in your word to come to you. So I pray today that we would allow the Holy Spirit to work in each one of our lives. That we would allow the Holy Spirit to loosen the grips of things we're so tightly holding on to. And that we would truly surrender it. Lay it at the foot of the cross. Give it to the one that can do all things. Give it to the one that is not limited. Now we have empty open hands. Receive the blessings that you have for each one of us. We have empty open hands. Receive your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness, your power, your strength. And gracious God, you have chosen to use us to make a difference in Ellsworth and wherever we go. That others can receive that love. That others can receive that grace, that forgiveness that we have freely received from you that we can give to them. I also pray if anyone needs a special touch today. Maybe they need to hear their name. Maybe they need to know they are loved, that they are forgiven, that you'll never leave, that you'll never forsake. So, dear Lord, just minister to each and every heart that needs that touch. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, all of God's people say, amen. Amen. So at this time, we'll have a call to worship.
Hello. Yet you desired faithfulness even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with eyes of, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity.
Gracious God, we thank you and praise you for the opportunity, dear Lord, to worship you, to praise you, to bring our prayers to the very throne room of God. We do this by the blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Dear Lord, you tell us to bring all our prayers to you and supplication with thanksgiving. Dear Lord, you know exactly what we need and even what we're about to say. And you tell us to come. We thank you for loving us and caring for us. We thank you for this community. We thank you for the opportunity, the freedoms that we have. We lift up our country for direction and guidance. Dear Lord, that we would repent, that we would turn back to you, that we would pray to you, we'd confess our sin, and that you would hear us, that you would heal us, heal this land. Dear Lord, we thank you again for your love for all the world. You love us so much that you gave your only begotten Son. And whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. We thank you and praise you for this time. Thank you for loving us and caring for us, for dwelling within each and every one that's put their trust and faith in you. Now, gracious God, we come to you in a prayer that Jesus taught the disciples. And as we say this prayer, I pray by your Spirit that we live out each and every word as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing Victory in Jesus. You'll find that in the hymnal number 370 or up on the screen. Victory in Jesus.
Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, we'll have the young disciples, and Jason's going to bring us a message. And then after that, we'll have Jesus Loves Me, but it'll be special music. And it'll be presented.
All right, so this morning, we've got several kids here. Hadlin's not here today. She's spending time with her auntie. And so it's a good morning for me to use her as a illustration for the topic that's today. Pastor is going to be talking about temptation and how to overcome that. Brielle, Ali, you guys know what temptation is? What would you say? How would you say what it is? Any ideas? How would you guys define temptation out there? Have you ever faced temptation? Yeah?
All of us.
All of us. And, temptation basically is when you have the desire, like you want to do something that you're not supposed to do, right? And I think we have that one way or another. Like whoever, who here uses alarms to wake up? Anybody? Some? Most? Okay, some of you do. I'm wondering, like, the guy who came up with the idea of a snooze button, to give us that temptation to sleep in a little longer, right? And to me as a teacher, it happens to me once a year that I hit it too many times and all of a sudden I'm scrambling. It felt good to sleep in a little bit, but now I'm going to have a room full of kids without me because of that. That's a temptation I face almost daily. Most of the time I'm able to get up and get there on time. So temptation, again, is basically wanting to do something you're not supposed to. Why are you not supposed to do it? Maybe because it could do some damage. It could hurt you, or it could hurt others. So that's why there's a reason someone tells us not to do that. And God does the same thing for us. He tells us, He gives us a set of guidelines of things we should do and shouldn't do. And I think Pastor will be talking today about how when that comes to our life, God always gives us the way out. He'll never give us too much that we can't say no to. Does that make sense? He'll always give us a chance to do the right thing every single time. This past week, Hadlin had to face some temptation. You know, like Pastor said, all of us have faced temptation from the very beginning when we were much, much younger. For Hadlin, when she was 2 years old, one of the things that people did was purposely put some delicious treats for kids on a table, and then they record it. They video it, and they tell their kid, hey, just make sure you don't eat that delicious treat. I'm just going to go do something real quick. Just to see how long the kid would follow the direction. Now, that's a little bit cruel, right? And Hadlin loves Cocoa Pebbles. And so I set a bowl of Cocoa Pebbles before. This was when she was 2. And I told her, Hadlin, just wait a minute. I got to go wash my hands. I'll be back, and then we can eat it together. So I recorded it. And she lasted about 2.5 minutes. She sat there and looked at the bowl of cereal, just looked at it. And then, of course, I was in the other room, you know, waiting to hear things. And so she's looking at the bowl. Then I hear a little bit of a stirring in the bowl, but she never took a bite. She got off the chair, did something on the fridge, came back and looked at the cereal again, and then when I came back 2.5 minutes later, I praised her on how awesome she did, that she followed my instructions. And now she's a year older and she doesn't do that anymore. Just this week, I think, Court had a story when I came home. She said, you know, she came from Bible study and she had some treats, some cookies and some chocolate in there. And so she sat that on the table and told Hadlin, hey, Grandpa's coming tomorrow and you can't have any of this now. But at lunch, when I come home for lunch, we can share it together, right? So that morning, on Friday morning, Grandpa was in the living room sitting, and Hadlin apparently came in with a cookie in her hand and said, "Hey, Grandpa, you want a cookie? I ate one already." So, and then Courtney came home for lunch, and her snack pack is gone, except for one chocolate. So Hadlin didn't just fall into temptation of the cookies. She didn't just not follow Mama's direction, but she then also got Grandpa in trouble. So both of them kind of were in trouble. And I think that story is in the Bible somewhere. You know, but those aren't serious things, kids and adults. But when we start facing more serious temptation, if we can handle the small things, then hopefully we can handle the big things. And today, Pastor will teach us, tell us about how Jesus helps us to overcome these. When we want to do things we're not supposed to, God will be there to help us make the right decisions. Amen? All right, let's close in prayer, and then Janelle and Allie will be bringing us the special music of Jesus Loves Me. Dear God, thank you for your love for us. We thank you that you're watching over us and you help us to make the good, the right decisions. Thank you for your guidelines to a good life. Help us to follow that, Lord. And when temptations are wanting to do things that aren't right, help us to choose the right path. And forgive us when we don't. And help us to continue to look to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Jesus loves me, he who died. Heaven gates to open wide. He will wash away my sin. Let his little child come in.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. He will stay close beside me all the way. He's prepared a place for me, and someday his face I'll see. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Now at this time, our hymn is Freely, Freely, and you'll find that in the hymn number 389 or up on the screen.
At this time, let us pray for all. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. We thank you for the opportunity to be in ministry with you. We ask, dear Lord, that you would bless this offering, because we know that all good things come from heaven above. Dear Lord, we know that this offering be utilized. That people will hear the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, of his life, of his death, and resurrection. Dear Lord, I thank you and praise you not only that you bless this offering, but dear Lord, that you would bless each and every one. For those that are able to give financially, for those that give of time and service, for those that pray, and for everyone's presence. Just minister to each and every heart, and we thank you and praise you again. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Another special, and I'm blessed because I sit up front and I get to see grandparents and parents just really enjoy, and this is such a blessing.
The first Noel.
the King, whom shepherds God and angels sing. Earth prays to bring him life, the babe, the Son of Mary.
That was beautiful. That was wonderful. And at this time, Pat will share a scripture with us from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 12 through 13.
Which will be up on the screen or in the Pew Bible on page 209. So if you think you are standing, watch out, not fall. No testing has overtaken you that is not common to everyone. God is faithful, and he will not let you be tested beyond your strength. But with the testing, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to endure it. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Pat. At this time, would you please bow your heads with me? Gracious God, I just humbly come before you today and just ask that you would give me the words, that they'd be your words and not mine, because your words never return void. As we look at how can I overcome temptation, dear Lord, that is one thing that is common, is that we're all tempted. And dear Lord, I know this isn't a sermon to how to get rid of temptation, because I know we'll have temptation. Each one of us will have temptation until we're at heaven's gate. But how do we deal with it? We thank you for your word that directs us and guides us. What a blessing it is. Just minister to each and every heart as we look and focus on interpretation, application of how we are to live. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. Maybe you have heard the story of the young priest serving in the confession booth for the very first time. He was being watched by an older priest who was his trainer, who was his mentor. And at the end of the day, the older priest took the younger man aside and had one piece of advice for him. He said, when a person finishes confession, you got to say something other than, wow. You know, when we think of the intensity of sin and the onslaught of temptation, we see sometimes we want to say, wow. Although human beings have been faced temptation since the days of Adam and Eve, sin never has been as successful as it is today. Evil has never been as user-friendly because of our technology mixed with the sinful tendencies of our fallen nature and the intensity intensified by Satan have put a capital T, if you would, in the word temptation. Sometimes we wonder whether we can stand against it or whether will be swept away like straw huts, if you would, carried off by a tsunami. It's just not for those major red letter temptations that assault us. for the daily stress of how now has created constant opportunities for us to yield to impatience, irritability, anxiety, profanity, and sharpness of tongue. I've wondered how Apostle Paul, if you could beam him down today, would advise us that he would speak directly to these issues. I believe he would say just what he has already said in God's inspired and timeless word. Imagine with me today, if Apostle Paul had received a letter from a young man who had been recently saved in the ancient city of Corinth. This was an evil city, just as evil as anywhere in today's world. The young man, having found Christ as Savior, had relished God's forgiveness for all of his sins, and he rejoiced in becoming a new creation in Christ. But to his astonishment, this fellow had discovered that he still was subject to the same temptations that had dogged him throughout his life. The evil passions that had controlled his life before conversion was still with him. He had encountered defeat again from the very things for which God had forgiven him. He was even beginning to doubt the reality of his conversion and question. He was questioning the true power of God. Now suppose this young man had written a desperate letter to Paul asking, "What do I do? What do I do?" Paul carefully answered this question as we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Here's the scripture again. "No temptation has seized you except what is common to man. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand under it." So the first is the common experience of temptation, as we see in the very first part, in verse 13, "No temptation has seized you except what is common to man." Temptation is common to all people. It's common to all believers because Apostle Paul was writing to those in Corinth, to the Corinthians. They were believers. And everyone is tempted. Let me say that again. Everyone is tempted. The issue is not possible to get rid of temptation, but how do we deal with it? Because we will continually be tempted. Most of us are not surprised to hear when others fall to temptation. But many times we're often surprised when we face it ourselves. We're not surprised when others, but ourselves are tempted. Temptation may change, but there is always temptation. Like a child tempted with candy or pebbles. Was it fruity or cocoa pebbles? Cocoa pebbles. Okay. Fruity can be, you know, and that's why they have two. No, one says no. Okay. My sister was, I remember. That's probably the only wrong thing she ever did. A teenager can be tempted with sensual temptations. A young adult with money. Or even an older adult may be tempted with power. But we're all tempted. And then we look at even the saints in the Old Testament and the New Testament struggle with temptation. In the Old Testament, we see temptations from Noah, was tempted with drunkenness. Abraham, deception. Moses, with temper. Elijah's with murmuring, and David's immorality, and Jonah's rebellious spirit. And then all we have to do is flip a few pages into the New Testament. You'll see Peter's denial, John Mark's defection, Timothy's anxiety, and Paul's arguing with Barnabas. Every soul who has walked on this earth has been tempted. Even Jesus faced temptation. In Hebrews 4:15, the scripture tells us, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet without sin." Only Jesus is the one that did not sin. He was sinless, he was blameless, but he was also tempted. We will not get rid of temptation, but the Lord will show us how to deal with it, how to be victorious, how to be an overcomer. The controlled environment of temptation. The second part in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, Paul tells us, "And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear." Temptation itself is not evil, but when we yield to it, it is evil. It is a sin. Martin Luther once said, "You can't stop birds from flying over your head, but you can stop them from nesting in your hair." It's getting easier and easier for me all the time. We are encouraged to fight temptation. Its ferocious pressure is felt. Temptation will follow us all the way to the gates of heaven. In James chapter 1, verse 13, when tempted, no one should say, "God tempted me." For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. God doesn't tempt us, but God does provide a way for escape. The devil is the one that tempts us. And we see this in Matthew 4 and 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. Peter, in 1 Peter 5:8, says, "Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour." God is faithful. God limits the test and the intensity. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 8 through 10. "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about hardships we suffer in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure, so that we despaired even of life. Indeed, in our hearts we felt the sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us. On him we have set our hopes that we will be continued, that he will continue to deliver us." When we hear that passage, there's three things that we see that Paul uses all three tenses of the word deliver. God has delivered us. God is delivering us. And God will deliver us. God is with us. He knows our limitations. And God has and will deliver us. The Lord knows that each of us, what we can endure. God knows exactly what you and I can endure when it comes to temptation. There are many uncertainties in the moment of temptation. But there is one uncertainty we can take off the table. God will provide a way of escape. God will provide a way. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13, Paul adds these reassuring words to the young pastor. If we are faithless, he remains faithful. He cannot deny himself. The faithfulness of God guarantees that there's no superhuman temptation will enter the life of any believer, and that each believer's temptation will correspond with his own ability to endure them, that we can endure them. God is the faithful Father who will never allow a temptation in my life that is more powerful than his ability to keep me. Remember that God is a faithful Father. He will never allow a temptation in your life that is more powerful than his ability to keep you. It's not your power, but it is the power of God. He maintains a controlled environment for our testing. God will not allow things to go beyond his control. And God had not forgotten about us. God controls what enters our lives, knowing the limits of what we can bear. Knowing the limits of what we can bear. The certain escape from temptation. Also from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, the very last part of this verse. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out so that you can stand up under it. God makes it so we can bear it. God sees the temptation from the beginning to the end. God gives us a means to escape at the very beginning. A way to escape. God gives this to us. It's always available. A way to escape. It is always there. In Hebrews chapter 2, verse 18 tells us, because he himself suffered when he was tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. This is our Lord and Savior. Is able to help us. It is not that what we can do, but who we can trust. Not what we can do, but who can we trust? Jesus changes everything. Let me say that again. Jesus changes everything. The word escape from the Greek word means a narrow pathway, a passage in a steep canyon that is very treacherous. If you do not see it, you will walk past this narrow pathway. But God can reveal that there is a way out. Every temptation has a way out, and we just need to see it. We just need to take it. We need to sense it. Many times it's the fleeting thought that I must not take it for granted. And we have a feeling that it is wrong. Right in that beginning, that temptation, you start feeling something, an inward unction. Maybe something in your gut saying, I can't do that. Look what it would do to my testimony. Look what it would do to my family. Because there is no secret sin. It's like throwing a rock in a pond and then it starts just expanding and expanding. Those rings. Because everyone is affected. Like I said, it may only last for a moment, but God provides a way out. But we have to take it. Instead of freedom, if we do not take it, we're locked in a canyon. And the three things of 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, that about temptation, it's a common experience. We all are tempted, but it's a controlled experience. God won't allow any more that we can bear, and there's a certain escape of temptation. Today, I'd also like to look at some practical biblical principles beyond 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, that we would recognize how temptation Everyone is tempted. It's just a matter of time. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12, the verse before what I've been talking about that Pat read to us, so if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. It's an arrogant attitude. I guarantee you, none of us are all that in a sack of chips. We will fall. We will fall. And many times, success, we fall into temptation when we're successful because we fall in that temptation because our defenses are down. I think of King David, how he stayed home instead of going with the army. He stayed home and he did a little channel surfing, if you would, up on the rooftop. He knew exactly what time Bathsheba would take that bath. He fell into that temptation, and it cost him dearly. Most are prone when things are going well. Like I said, our defenses are down. And Proverbs 16:18 tells us, pride goes before destruction, a haughty spirit before a fall. Pride is the number one sin that Satan uses in temptation. Two, we need to pray about temptation in advance. Every morning we need to pray, dear Lord, lead me not in temptation. We just did it a little while ago from Matthew 6:13 in the Lord's Prayer. And lead me not in temptation, but deliver me from the evil one. And in Matthew 26:41, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. Third, that we would resist the devil and he will flee. From James chapter 4, verse 7. Submit yourself then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Jesus resisted in the desert. He was submitted to God. And he quoted three times from Deuteronomy using God's holy word. And we can do the same thing. We would retreat. Four, that we would retreat from certain kinds of temptations. That we would run away from immorality, greed, and idolatry. They have increased power in humanity. So we need to run away from immorality, greed, and idolatry. Or you will be victimized. You will be a victim. In Genesis, we see Joseph. When the wife of Potiphar was trying to take advances and trying to tempt him, Joseph ran. He even left his coat. Yeah, he left some, even though it was a lie, but it would look like evidence, but he ran away. He ran away. Number five. Remove any means of sin from your life. In Romans 13:14, rather clothe yourself with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of sinful nature. Get rid of that thing. I remember hearing a story of a young staff member. He was an associate pastor. And there was a woman that would flirt with him, and he had the opportunity to be at a women's retreat, and he was to be there. And she even had a table and had it where he would sit next to her. And so he thought he would go talk to the senior pastor. And when he talked to the senior pastor about this woman that flirted with him, he said, "Pastor, don't you think there's safety in numbers?" And the senior pastor said, "Yes, but there's even more safety in Exodus." Yeah, you don't have to laugh at that one, but it's in the Bible. I struggle, and a temptation for me is food. I truly have a food addiction. And I don't know if you're aware of this, but there's convenience stores in this community that has donuts. And one shouldn't pray. I mean, we should pray about our temptation. But we shouldn't say, now, dear Lord, if you don't want me to have a donut, I pray that there wouldn't be a parking spot right in front of the door. And I don't know if you're like me, but if you pray that prayer and you circle around the block 11 times until someone moves out of that, that is not what we're talking about. We need to refocus our life. We need to refocus our life. Passion's greater than temptation. What I'm talking about, the overwhelming faith of righteousness, is so much better than selfishness and sin. What God has for us is so much greater than any temptation. What I'm talking about is the dog principle. When someone has trained their dog where they can put meat or bread in front of the dog and the dog won't take it, they look to the master. I asked that question in Kannapolis before I came here, and I found out there's only one person that knows how to train a dog correctly in Kannapolis. But one said that Preston had his dog trained where he would set the food down, but if he didn't tell the dog to eat it, that dog wouldn't touch it for even 5 minutes, they said. Twice as long as Hadlin. But what I'm saying is, and don't ask me to train the dog. No. But what I'm saying, that dog principle is, whatever that temptation is, that we would look to the master. We'd look to the master instead of that temptation. And visualize not only looking to the eyes of Jesus, but I may be also looking at the eyes of your spouse or your children or grandchildren or friends or peers. But look to the master. Look to Jesus. It's so much greater than any temptation. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you and praise you. We know that temptation is common to all. But dear Lord, we thank how temptation is controlled by you, that nothing is too great for you, and that you provide a way to escape. And when we have that prompting, when we have that prodding, that we follow it. I thank you again for what we have in you. Just minister to each and every heart, and that we would keep our eye on the Master. These things we pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen and amen. Now at this time, if you're comfortable standing, would you please stand as we sing, O Come With Joy, verses 1, 4, and 5 on page 617 or on the screen. God, we just thank you and praise you what we have in you. You are so much greater than anything else. Just continually to minister to each and every heart, and that we would share what we have in you. So I send them out in your power. Power of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' precious name, amen and amen. God bless you all.